afternoon of you. Thank you very much for being here. Now we're ready for our afternoon session. We're going to have a presentation by Dr. Adrian Sandu from the Computational Science Laboratory, Virginia Tech, in the US, okay? So he's going to talk about a few directions in data simulation. So Dr. Sandu, welcome. Thank you very much again for your visit. And we are ready to listen to you.
Yes, thank you again, Elias, Olga, for organizing this workshop and for the invitation. Okay, so this is a group picture of our lab from 2015.
2015, yeah.
Did you remember somebody?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is Elias. A student, like you. And his colleagues. At the time. Okay, so. Instead of picking a topic and diving deep, I'd like to do something else, that is discuss a number of directions, a number of things that we'll be working on, and hopefully this will spark some interest for exploring further these topics in your guess. So these are the directions that I would like to discuss to pitch to you. The first one is robust data simulation. The second one is using Bayes' theorem to learn localization of ADI from the data. Third one and fourth are employing machine learning techniques to help in data simulation. And then a few other topics we have time and energy. We may or may not discuss. Okay, so direction number one is robust data simulation. Okay, so to warm up the audience, this is a simulation that we ran already many years ago, this is 2010. It's a system that students in the group built. This is the variation of the data simulation system for NASA's EOSCAM. It's all being used to import for emissions of carbon and many other things. It is a global chemical transport model. And that solves the following question, right? If we use data collected by the Tropospheric Emission Spectrometer, which is an instrument on board of the Aura satellite in the NASA main plane. Okay, so the satellite looks down, it has an ambient view, and every time it looks down, it measures radiances in different wavelengths. Some of those wavelengths are associated with the distribution of ozone in the atmosphere. So every time the satellite goes down, it measures essentially the color distribution of ozone. The satellite is a polar orbiter, so goes around the pole, comes back, and so on. In about 2 weeks, the satellite comes back to the original position and continues to explore. So for this, we use an assimilation window of 2 weeks for the data collected by the satellite in 2 weeks. In order to validate the 4DVAR system that we built, we used an independent data set collected by disposal cells, right? Disposal balloons that were launched some locations, sometime during the 2 weeks period, August 2015, 2007. So what we have here are mean errors. There is differences between the columns predicted by the model, ozone columns predicted by the model, and ozone columns measured by the ozone sounds. Of course, the model predictions were interpolated to match the locations and the times of the ozone sounds. Okay, so what we have here is vertical coordinate in pressure. And what we have on the x-axis are errors, relative errors, percentage errors, between model predictions and ozone cell data. So initially, the model underpredicts ozone by quite a lot with
around 200 hectopascals or tropospheric boundary, having the largest under predicament. With two types of filters, the Illuminative one is really high, another one is suboptimal thermal filter. We see a lot of improvement. And again, there is a single data source. Only the satellite data is super strict, the ozone. And 40 bar, we get the most likely results. You can imagine that this is a large calculation. This is the total model. We need to do a 2-week prediction, and 2-week backwards the upgrade, and so on for about 30 iterations to converge to a good enough solution. Okay, so now, in data simulation, what happens when the observations surprise the model? Data outliers are very common occurrence. Now, when the data in the model disagree, one of two things can happen. Possibility one, the data is not good, the sensor is broken, but there is a possibility, namely, the data is very informal. The data tells us something that the model doesn't know. Because of this, the traditional data quality control that is based on rejecting observations, pre-processing, post-processing observation, pre-processing the report, using them in the data simulation system, and throwing away the outliers. That's not a good idea. Okay? And this has been well established now from the work of this and other work. So what we need a way to allow these surprising data points to be used by the system. But in case that these data points are not accurate, they don't have much information, we need these data points to not impact the analysis too much. Okay? So the surprising data is to do errors. We don't want those errors to corrupt our analysis too much. In the same time, we don't want to serve the piece of information right away, because if it is good data, we want to use it. Okay? How do we do this? Well, the answer is robust data simulation. Robust data simulation is based on using robust error statistics in the formulation of the data simulation problem. Look on the left panel, we have probability density functions for the Gaussian, which is the blue curve, for the exponential e to negative absolute value of x, and to the Hubbard that is on this formula has an exponential behavior, e to minus absolute value of x behavior in the tail, and e to minus x squared behavior near the tip. In terms of distributions, this is Gaussian distribution. The green one corresponds to Laplace distribution. And this interesting one that is smooth and is Gaussian near the peak and exponential near the tails is called a Hubbard distribution. Okay? Now, why philosophically do we want to use probability densities that have long tails? Gaussian distribution, the tail goes to small values very, very quickly. Exponential distribution, the tail goes to zero, but at a much slower pace. Why would this help us to the problem of assimilating data that is part of the model? Well, think that you have to fit a distribution, and you have a data point that is somewhere here. It's an outlier, right? To accommodate it, if we use a Gaussian probability, this outlier will have a very, very, very low probability. So to accommodate it with a Gaussian, the Gaussian will need to shift by column, right? Until a non-trivial part of the state sort of covers the point. Okay. However, if we use one of those long-tail distributions, if we have an outlier, the probability is not that infinitesimal is 4, it's still okay. So this distribution will only be to accommodate the outlier. case of philosophical, this is how robust distributions help us perform robust data simulation. If we take the negative log of this, we obtain the corresponding norms. Negative log of the Gaussian gives us an L2 norm. Negative log of the Laplace distribution gives us an L1 norm. And the one that behaves like Gaussian near the peak and has a long tail is the Hoover norm. And you see that we have a parameter that is, we can choose how long shall become the Gaussian before switching to the exponential distribution. Motivation. What difference does it make if we use robust statistics rather than L2 Gaussian statistics in the analysis? Okay? So consider the following basic things. We have a scalar variable that is described by a Gaussian vector, value of 10 and variance of 1. And we have two observations that have values 11 and 12. And they are, the errors are from a distribution with variance of 1. Okay? So assuming that we have Gaussian observation errors, the analysis gives us a value of 11. Okay, so we have a 10 and a 12. The uncertainties are the same, so the middle value is where the Gaussian assimilation settles. Now, the second observation is an outlier. Instead of the value 12, we have a value 20. With the Gaussian error assumptions, the analysis is perturbed by quite a lot, right? So instead of the dilemma, the analysis is changed by a lot because of this one outlier data. Now, if instead of assuming that the observation error is Gaussian, if we make the observation, the assumption that the observation errors follow a Hoover distribution, and I'll tell you exactly what it is, then we solve the optimization problem, we solve the, for the maximum Laplace theory that you penalizing the discrepancies between the variable and the data in hyperbole. Then we get an analysis that is 11.37. Okay? You see that the outlier changes or impacts our analysis to a much smaller extent than for the case where we assume Gaussian distributions.
So what would the solution be in the first case if you assume the
normal? It would be the same.
Yeah.
Okay, now, Hoover norm. Okay, so if we use the Hoover distribution, Hoover looks like a Gaussian near the peak. And then it looks like an exponential toward the tails. So the tails are much longer. Okay, if we continue imaginarily this exponential distribution, we will get a Laplace distribution. So we can think of a Hoover distribution as being a distribution where the small errors have a Gaussian distribution, but the large errors, the errors that lead in the tail, have a Laplace distribution.
Okay.
Is this reasonable? Is this something that we made up? Well, apparently, this is something very reasonable. And this is from a paper 2014 by ECMWF, where they looked at the statistics of radio sound temperatures. And they concluded that the statistics looks very much like a Hoover distribution. Okay? Yes?
I guess that the distribution is
once you have the right, once you have the equations, you can fit a parameter tau for an appropriate Hubbard bar. Okay? But the errors don't die with you. The errors die slowly. So having this assumption that small errors have a Gaussian distribution, while large errors have a Laplace distribution, is reasonable. And it's also very helpful from the point of view of robustness. Okay, so I'm talking about previous work, but none of the PDNs in a lot of approximations that take us away from the original intent. So I'll show you how this can be done. Data simulation that we're not able to consistently. Okay. If we have a 40 bar problem, we build a cost function. The scale departures of the scale innovations, if you want, departures of the model from the data, we denote this by variable z. And instead of using an L2 squared norm for analyzing the departures, we use a Hubbard norm. Okay? Now, we have to solve this problem. This is no longer a least squares type problem. This one is a Hubbard norm. But we have algorithms coming from the optimization community that can help us solve this problem. So this algorithm, alternating direction, method of multipliers, or half-quadratic optimization algorithms, both work both for the case where you penalize the data errors by Hubbard norm, or you penalize them by L1 norm, when we assume that all the errors have a distribution. Okay, so I'll just show you, I will skip the variation, but I'll just show you how to build a robust ensemble calculator. This is done using, again, the similarity or correlation between optimization in a subspace and what the calculator is. So every state in the subspace spread by the ensemble members, or the affine subspace spread by the ensemble members, can be written as the mean plus a weighted sum of the deviations of the ensemble. In the traditional LP-MTF, the weights of the mean are obtained by minimizing this cost function, where the background has now been scaled to unity, and the data reconstructed in the full space is the one that we use to measure the discrepancy from the data. So we saw this formula in Gabe's talk earlier, yesterday. Now, in the EDKF, this is the weight associated with the mean analysis. The weights associated with the analysis ensemble members, with each of the ensemble members, are obtained by building the square root of the spectrum. And adding columns of this square root to the mean analysis. Okay, so sort of perturbations by the mean ensemble space. In the quaternion MTF, in the original Evanson MTF formulation, the weights of the ensemble can be formulated in a very long, very close formulation. Okay. So how do we solve a robust EMTF problem? First, what problem do we solve? We minimize, again, in the ensemble space. The background didn't change, but the discrepancies between model predictions and data have changed in the sense that we penalize them with a different norm. We use a different statistical assumption for the data errors. Formally, we introduce this constraint that this variable z are the scale innovations. And this just helps the optimization algorithm. And this just helps the computation algorithm that eventually doesn't bring anything different. The easiest way to solve the problem is iteratively by this half quadratic minimization algorithm. So what we do is, in step one, we calculate updates based on this function applied to the scaling operations. Okay, it's a component by component function. So this one can apply. What it does, it just takes the threshold that you use in the Hoover one divided by A. If A is large enough for it, it's a constant. If A is small enough. Next, we solve an optimization problem. We apply the ensemble gamma filter, but with a scaled covariance matrix for the data. And the scaling is done by simply inserting these weighting factors that we computed on the screen in between the negative square roots of the matrix. Okay? Again, this can be formulated. So this formalism accounts for both square root filters and the original levels and quarter loss relations. Okay? So instead of sorting one optimization problem, we sort it immediately. At every solution, we rescale the covariance of the data. If we are satisfied with the convergence after any iterations, we use the converged covariance in the LDTF fashion to generate the weights of the analysis ensemble. Okay? So what is the short story here? We can build robust ensemble gamma filters, both in the original formulation and in the square formulation. The computational step involves solving the equations multiple times. Each solution requires a rescaling of the covariance matrix. Since we perform the solutions in the sample space, this is a fairly expensive computational position. So how does it work? These are numerical results. It's a Lorentz 96 model. And I should have mentioned probably that Elias is a co-author of this paper, which appeared in 2017. Okay, so Lorentz 96 model. You have the RMSC in time. This is the forecast. We have observations with only small random errors. In this case, the L2 and the robust optimization input results. If some sensors start to flip, some inject the data into the assimilation, we see that the L2 analysis pretty much follows the errors in the data, while the robust algorithms still give good results. The same happens for the shallow water equations on the sphere. When we have only observations with more random errors, the standard setting for the Gaussian theory is developed. There is no difference between Hoover and L2 analysis. But when we have some sensors misfiring, the Hoover ensemble, no, this is what you want. So the Hoover solution doesn't change much, but the L2 solution, the traditional formula, is quite important. LDTF in the vanilla version, robust, and the Gaussian version with the same results if the data is not occurred. The vanilla version of the Gaussian version of LDTF gives not so good results when you have the data. The solution is changed by that. The robust formulation of LDTF is still perturbed, so we still see errors in the data. But the errors in the resulting analysis are much smaller.
we have achieved our goal of building robust data simulation, robust ensemble common filters. Ensemble common filters where the analysis is not perturbed too much by errors in the data. Okay, so I think that's all for direction number one.
Tail of the distribution changes.
It is important. There is an optimal version. In the Cooper's original paper, this one was key. We don't have to use it. Lest if we have empirical distributions of the data errors, we can fit those, like this and that. If we don't want to do anything special, we can just work on scale. If we choose a larger tau, we allow more errors, we have Gaussian, and fewer outliers to be on the data. So we use between 1.3 and 2 in our experiments.
You have to post data to verify what you're doing. We normally have used a procedure where if the distance between the ensemble mean prediction and the measurement is larger than some standard deviations of the measurement and the ensemble, then we say that it's an outlier and we don't assume that it's related. So that's just a filter of screening out measurements. And in a way, you obtain.
We obtain the same.
Okay, so we see a WF in the 40 bar with some intermediates that we can show are not in the whole time, but related to North Sweden. This is a very popular number for the analysis. What do you do if you have innovations that are too large? Probably this doesn't.
And the reason for that is that even if the observations are correct, but the distance between the sample and the observation is too large, you get too strong violent updates.
You have a poor background in a certain region in physical observations.
But you think it's worth the extra effort to introduce the supernorm for the data or solve it? It's potentially more expensive.
It is, right? So you have to repeat, you have this outer loop. If you have an ensemble framework, then you repeat the calculations in the same ensemble space. If you are in a linear case, you do iterations anyway, so you can evaluate the data, do the iterations. If you are in the 40 part, it's even more difficult, because you have to repeat the 40 part cycle a number of times while reweighing the data. But some form of this, which is not exactly the proof of it, they think it's super complicated. Anyway, some version of it, repeating cycles, which we see later, is being used in the operational system. So the question, is it worth it? Depends by how much effort you are going to spend and how much concern you are about this data. Any comments?
Yeah. I understood that you use a polar to validate the that.
So in the example,
the observation is a polar.
There are two issues. Sorry for showing you more pictures of different people in the same time. So the first was just to warm up the, just to start the discussion. That's not robust. That's just plain L245. But it's a bigger application that we ran. It's a system that we did the model. And it's not in use by us. And we may come back to other results from this experiment later on.
But the question was related to the fact that why to use satellite data from a polar orbit satellite instead of geostationary.
In our case, the answer is simple. That's what NASA wanted from us in this project. We want to show our management that we can constrain the global distribution of ozone by the measurements of mass. Why? Because management, hopefully, seeing these good results with a good money for a next generation satellite and so on. Okay. There are many more data points from other satellites, from ground stations that we can use to constrain. But that's the one thing. A very precise question. Okay, so build a system for us, at least for 3 years, building a bigger grid, it's a considerable effort. And then use it to show, help us show the management, the data from one satellite is good enough to constrain the predictions of global. Okay? Okay, so a little bit like Arnold, I wanted to show that we've done things that are practical as well, not only. Adaptive localization. We've seen a number of talks where localization was discussed, especially Professor Ingerbiges gave us a great review of why localization is important. Now, how can we perform adaptive localization? Why in the world do we even need adaptive localization? Localization is supposed to bring into the system information about how the fields of errors decorately in space. Okay? If you have a chemical transport system, if you look at the empirical decorrelation time for the shorty species like nitrogen oxides, you will see that the decorrelation time is of the order of hundreds of meters, 1 kilometer. If you look at the decorrelation length of errors in a rogue species like ozone, you will see that this is of the order of 100. And if you look at the decorrelation length in errors of carbon dioxide, this is thousands of kilometers. So one size fits all, one radius fits all the variables in the system, at all times and in all locations. Clearly, we know that this doesn't work. Sometimes we cannot do better, because we don't know how, because we don't know if we invest the computational time, but sometimes we can do better. So the purpose of adaptive localization is to learn a good localization radius from the data. So what is the idea in the Bayesian approach? Different variables, okay, if you think multivariate localization, different variables have different decorrelation length. As you said, nitrogen oxides, very short correlation length, ozone, longer correlation lengths, carbon monoxide, very low correlation length. Now, when you want to build a filter or a weighting factor to rescale the computed correlation between text and text, what do you do because you don't have two correlation lengths? What we propose to do is to use a function that sort of blends the two. There are many possible functions that have the mathematical properties in here, but think of it as being the median of them, right? So we have the localization function applied to the distance between the variables, but with the decorrelation length of the first variable, the decorrelation of the second variable, and we average them somehow. Okay? Then the localization submatrix is symmetric and has all the right properties. If we use the right mixing function here. Now, what is the idea of the Bayesian approach to adaptive localization? So let's call, like mu, the parameters of the localization steps, and we can have inflation parameters as well, but I'll talk about it. Okay? The parameters of the data simulation scheme. The analysis depends on the background, depends on the data. And of course, the analysis depends on how we tune our analysis system. Parameter chosen, localization API, assume. Now, using Gray's identity, we now try to learn both the state and the parameters of the assimilation scheme from the data. In order to apply the Boolean framework, we need a prior for the parameters. And we have made the assumption here that the radii are independently distributed. Radii have a background, probability density that is independently distributed. And each of them is distributed according to a common distribution with two parameters. Okay? So this keeps the radii positive. This favors some radii over the other. In particular, it inhibits the use of very large radii. Okay? Because the gamma is nicer. So using Gray's identity, we try to find the posterior. We try to look for, learn both the state and the parameters of the assimilation scheme from the data. If we take the negative log of this, the Gaussian assumptions here, we have a function that involves the departure of the analysis from the data, the departure of the analysis from the background, and the background is coming from the prior assumed on the radii. In order to solve this, to find the optimal parameters in a maximum posteriori sense, we have to do a lot of approximations because the postulation is a bit ugly. But nevertheless, this can be done. So if we look at what this adaptive localization requires us in a quasi-closed-topic model, we have the RMSC obtained from the assimilation. And these are the RMSCs plotted against different inflation factors. We repeated the process with different inflation factors for each of them, learning the VTI, optimal VTI, and repeating the assimilation. The constant, optimal, hand-tuned, one radii fits all, gives us the RMSC of the blue curve, and the radii chosen by the algorithm gives the red curve, so it improves errors in the analysis. And if we look at the radii chosen by the algorithm, right, so this is the mean, you see, the radii changed a lot in the first steps.
So you're seeing a constant radius in the ultimate form,
not exactly something at all. Partitioning into subdomains. In each of the subdomains, you have a different radius. And they change from one step to another, but you have a much more dynamic radii. Different radii in different subdomains.
So it's always some kind of circular domain of influence.
In this case, the radius, the localization function is talking about.
Yes. Yeah.
And it's one radius in the domain and another radius in the domain. We can play different things. Okay. But this is a sample from the chosen API. And they do very
well. You're assuming here that all the model components have the same radius, right? Or you're varying across different model components.
This is quasi-geostropic, so we don't have too many model components. But we have a special distribution of those. And to account for the special distribution, we split the domain into tiles. And in each tile is the same radius.
Okay. So you create like local clusters of each cluster?
Yes. Now, once you have the machinery in place, you can play different games and choose things in different ways. I'm still waiting for discussions from the students. Randy? You are on the spot. Questions, comments? Things that sound interesting?
So, about the numerical solution of the cost function, how do you solve it?
That's where a lot of approximations come in.
Okay.
This way. We can discuss.
Okay.
All the steps that we have taken is in the paper. Are in the paper. the disadvantage is that it's not simple. Professor Quintero,
no,
comments?
No, I'm telling you that I just shut up because you want them to ask the question.
It's just silly.
Well, can we feed the ready at a different rate without the distribution? In the previous slide, it was sweet, I was like a gas.
Yeah.
Can we feed the array with another distribution, another different than the gamma?
Yes. Yes.
How will it behave? Why will we choose the gamma? What does it give to us? The other distribution does.
Okay, so the gamma distribution gives us positive values. And it dies out, meaning that this prior distribution favors reasonably small radii and sort of penalizes large radii of the algorithms trying to bring in a lot of the data, basically going contrary to the very idea of focalization. Some of the algorithms try to choose a very large radii. This background will penalize another algorithm. Very good question. Professor Nino Ruiz, where's the dissector side? Answering questions. Forcefully.
Yeah.
Okay. Direction number three. Professor Nino Ruiz, talk about machine learning. Can we use machine learning to help our data simulation system? Can we use machine learning to learn the readiness from the data? So what is the approach to learn good localization readiness? And I'll tell you straight up that we use the random forest approach as the machine learning algorithm, but you can use neural networks, you can use other algorithms as well. So in order to feed a machine learning algorithm to learn something, right, you need to tell the algorithm, this is the input data. You need to tell the algorithm, this is the criteria that we want it to feed. This is what is good, this is what is not good. We need to give a loss function, not a cost function. So, since our models live in a large space, we cannot give the entire field of values as input to a machine learning algorithm. We have to select a number of features that are relevant and feed those to the learner. Next, how do we decide? What is the loss function that discriminates between good radii and not so good radii? Okay, so look at two things in this case. One of them is the root mean square of the analysis. But it turns out that this is not enough. We have to look at the quality of the ensemble that come out of the assimilation algorithm. So we look at the uniformity of the rank histogram. Okay, so we have two criteria, R and C, and the uniformity of the rank histogram. And we plot them using a complex combination. Was that your strophic model? Stream function, like reference to ensemble here. And these are some results from the machine learning approach to learning localization impact. I don't believe you can read it, because I cannot read myself. So, RMSC, assimilation cycles. This curve here is the RMSC of the normal filter with a hand-tuned and optimized assimilation readiness. This is the training phase, and this is the data that we use to train the machine. This is the testing phase. So, outside the training phase, very difficult. Using different weights to combine the criteria, RMSC and quality of the rank histogram, we obtain different results, but the better ones, if we can modify, lead to an RMSC that is much lower than the training phase.
factorize here, but liquid RMS is also much lower in the distance. So if we have the time to invest and train a learning algorithm to, based on some features of the solution, give us an API, there is hope that this can help us in testing phase when applied to other problems. Okay, so there are two PG models, so that's why the numbers are different for the ADI. Yeah.
In the problems I'm working with the rest of the models, then a radius is not useful. We need, because you have long range correlations and very heterogeneous in different directions. And it could be regions that very have strong correlations, and which is isolated from other regions. And that makes the localization much more difficult.
So, yeah, we can really practice in the localization in an isotropic way. But and then we could have more parameters.
But could you have completely arbitrary, like selecting grid points that should be updated from particular data, grid point by grid point, like, in a slow power?
Okay, so tuning the localization grid point by grid point?
Yeah.
Yes. Once you learn the pattern that leads to the solution, to the localization function, once you learn it, under the assumption that it generalizes, then yes, you can apply it with the in principle, is it possible to learn something that is anisotropic? In principle, it is possible, we have done it. But this can be something to look into. We have more parameters to learn. The hope with this is exactly that we spend a lot of effort in training the machine, but then we can deploy it whenever we feel like. Because computing with the machine on this train is not that difficult. So it's very inexpensive. Direction number four. Again, making use of machine learning. But this time, to help us quantify and set up in big models that are of interest to us. Okay, so numerical reproduction models, for example, incorporate a variety of physical processes. For the world fusers, in order to configure over time, you need to choose processes that go into the model. And for each process, you have different implementations, different physical parameterization schemes. So there is a combinatorial explosion of possibilities in order to configure the model, in order to choose the right elements. There is no criterion to tell you how to do it. Some combinations of physical processes work well in some instances for some algorithmic conditions, but they don't work well for others. So our goal is to use learning to understand the interplay between the choice of physics and the accuracy of the resulting forecasts under different conditions. We look to learn two different functions. The first one looks at the parameters of the model and some errors or states in the recent past, and tries to predict some aspects of the forecast error. Okay, here you cannot predict everything, but maybe some aspects of the forecast error can be predicted. And the second function that we want to learn is looking at some errors, some error fields. Can we predict, perhaps in hindsight, what is a combination of physical parameters that is consistent
What is the structure of the errors that we fed the algorithm? Now is the vector function. And so, function number one that we have. Trying to use machine learning to predict something, learn something about the forecaster. We look at precipitation computed by the weather research and forecast. So the truth, we take the SF analysis, that's the truth, and this is the world forecast without doing anything about it, except starting it from the right initial conditions. Okay, with some choice of parameterization. We look at precipitation, because it's one of the more difficult to predict variables, one of the more sensitive variables, also one of the more sensitive outcomes to the way we choose the physical processes in the configuration of the model. Okay, so based on the history of errors, we try to predict, if you want, the forecast errors over Virginia. Why over Virginia? It seemed like a good choice at the time. So, if we look at the SF analysis and the original work prediction, we see that there is a difference in the precipitation amount in this front. The difference between the SF analysis and the original work forecast is a field like this. So, the difference is of 2-3 millimeters in accumulated precipitation. It is substantial. Okay? Now, we use the work simulation results and our understanding of the errors using the train machine to predict, if you want, the forecast error over Virginia. Okay, so it's one small aspect of the forecast error. We add this predicted error field to the work forecast, and we compare it again the correctness field to the SF analysis. Okay, and we get a much smaller error. I'm not advocating doing machine learning instead of the model. What I'm saying is, there is hope to use machine learning algorithms to understand more about the forecast errors. Okay? Not to replace the model, but to do other things. We have a lot of things that we need to do with the forecast errors or estimates of the forecast errors. Right? Okay, so problem number two. What physical processes contribute most to the error in the work precipitation forecast? Using the machine learning algorithm as a surrogate for the model and looking at changes in the error fields and the corresponding parametrizations that are consistent with the changes in the error fields, we concluded that this is the ordering, right? So the shortwave radiation physical value contributes the most, followed by the longwave radiation, the cumulus, and the microphysics processes. Okay. So that's it about machine learning for you. As I promised, we will look in the direction of watching. Stop here or talk about other things, other directions. Other directions. When we perform a simulation, we know that we have data with errors, and we know that we have errors in the model. The big question is, what is the impact of those errors onto the net result, onto the analysis? Okay. Since the times of Mihaly Alekseev, Elias, we have this machinery of computing sensitivities of the analysis of the optimal solution with respect to different things in the optimization process. So this is how they are applied to quantifying the impact of errors in data and the impact of errors in the model what is the simulation result? So this scenario uses data from April 2011, and these are the assimilated things over the continent, which is the simulation scenario. One of the data pieces used in the simulation is the wind data from Joe and okay, so both you and the observations. Now, for a certain period, the period that we covered, the errors reported by UAMD correspond to this. Okay, so these are just the errors in the data as reported by the UAMD program. Now, if we consider our quantity of interest to be the mean temperature in the analysis field at the ground level. Okay. So we seek to compute the impact on one scalar quantity, and we choose the scalar quantity in this example to be the mean ground level temperature in the analysis field. The impact factors of these errors onto the analysis are given by these fields, and if we multiply the total price, we can multiply them by the field. These are the contributions of the individual errors into errors in the resulting analysis temperature at the end of the 40-month cycle. Okay? Now, model errors. This is the field of temperature model errors in the first level of the model. How did we generate the model errors? By taking out one of the particulate modules. It changes the radiation of the ground, the filtration of radiation of the ground. Okay? So if we use this complete model, we get some truth. And if we use the model without a physical process, we get an erroneous model that has these errors. What is the impact of these model errors onto our quantity of interest, which is the mean temperature at ground level in the analysis field? Okay, so I will only show you the impact factors. Somehow, the errors in this region in North Florida seem to impact the most, model errors in this region seem to impact the most, the mean temperatures in the analysis.
So the way how you quantify model errors, first, and you add up more frequent basis, right?
That's how we generate the model results.
Oh,
so we have the full model,
you have the full model.
And then we use the simple physics essentially.
And, then
and that's the erroneous model.
So the missing
for this erroneous model, we have to handle all 1 meter or something. We do the assimilation with the erroneous model.
And then we measure.
And then we see what kind of errors are made in the analysis. Because we have the model of servers.
It's like a cross-validation with the same model, just with the model. You have a full model, then you start adding or removing things and see what is the behavior of the quantity filters, right?
So, in a way, but the intent here is not to cross-validate, the intent is to quantify the errors in the model. If somebody comes at me and says, quantify the errors more, I will say, no.
Yeah.
But, okay, in this, let's say, test case, I can build a worth version that has some numbers. And we do this by changing one of the physical processes.
What I'm doing now to quantify errors is working with functional data analysis. You already assume that you have the entire domain and treat them as a functional data. You run the entire data so because you have a model.
What we are doing right now, because of you have a model and you have these scarce measurements, in order to quantify it, what we are doing right now in my group is to assume you got this functional data analysis as a tool. If you assume that your entire domain and your grids, each one of them on time is an observation, so you can perform a robust estimation on the deviation, just to quantify how deviated it is. Because of, from my point of view, if you just measure the bias, it's not a accurate possible error quantification. So somehow inducing a process on the entire grid and all data points would be more or less something that offers not necessarily a mean. It's more like a, I'll show you before this. It's like a representation on the entire time domain model against observations. And when you have just a few of them, they are becoming part of your functional data. So then you may just analyze the entire process. But I'll show you that before.
Yeah, but I think on that the point here is that the, in this case, no information coming from the data is observation. Yeah, because we are like measuring the model errors. The model errors should be independent of observations, right?
Independent, but if you compare against any other physical process or whatever, you're just comparing model against model. So now this is my understanding of the situation.
Yeah, okay. So if you have a description of the model errors, this technique allows you to find the impact of those model errors onto the analysis. So you can try to answer questions like, what is a simpler model that I can use in a simulation?
Yeah.
The model errors in a simpler model, maybe they don't matter to the simulation result, right? And the same with the data. What kind of errors in the data I can tolerate without having them impact my analysis, and what kind of errors in the data I cannot tolerate, okay? Okay, so you see this example. One interesting question is the following. So the satellite takes a lot of measurements, there are a lot of data points. Different instruments take different measurements. We know that not all data is created equal. We know that some data is more useful for the simulation, other data is less useful, and some data is just detrimental to the quality of the analysis. Okay? So how can we quantify the information content of data? How do you define information content of data? Using information theory, of course. The information content roughly can be described as, can be defined as the reduction in uncertainty resulting from using the data in the conversion process, in the assimilation process. Okay, so information has to do with reduction of uncertainty. If you look at all the data, and there are many data points taken by the satellite, we build methods to estimate the information content of data using different information theoretic metrics. Release of error for signal is one of them. For each of the data points, using our approximation technique, we calculate the information content. And if we plot the data points that are in the 20% range, according to information content, so the 20% most informative data, according to our estimate, are here. And the bottom 20% informative data, according to our estimate, are here, right? Our statement about 250 pascals. Now, if we assimilate, so these are the 40 bar results, if we assimilate them, if we now repeat the assimilation process, but we improve 80% of the data points, we keep only the 20% that our algorithms said are the most informative. Okay, we get an analysis that is almost identical to the analysis obtained with all the data at our disposal. We flip the coin and we keep for assimilation only 20% of the data points, but this time we keep the data points that were deemed less disinformative by our algorithm. And if we assimilate those, we obtain an analysis that is not different than the data. Okay. So that's a confirmation that the algorithm that we have to
need to quantify this information. You need to quantify information content of individual data points. These are something that you see. Okay, so I start here. We talk about robust data assimilation, and I give a reference here. See, Dr. Minor is. We talked about Bayesian localization. We talked about the use of machine learning for localization and for compute. You have the references here, but one point to find them is to look at our course web page publications, and there are an Ilkin server where all the technical reports are. Okay, so I'll stop here. Glad to take questions.
Thank you.